that? Did we scare everybody? Come on, Mike. We're gonna do it.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. I'm Michael. Welcome to Open Gate. Glad to see you this morning. I'm glad everybody could be out here. Thank God. Thank God you're here. We have so much going on in our church. They'll be making the announcements a little later. If you want to watch the service, you can watch it on Facebook. And, you know, if you have YouTube, you can type anything in the search engine, you know, as you could type Open Gate and it'll come up. Anything you're looking for will show up. And so the services are also on YouTube. We're going to pray this morning for this worship service. Lord, thank you for this service, Lord. Thank you for all the things you've done in our lives. Your word tells us where there's two or three gathered, you are in their midst. So, Lord, you're here this morning in the midst of us. We thank you for the word of God that comes forward. Thank you that we can learn, and not only learn, we can live it. Thanks for giving us that power of prayer. We pray everything, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You guys ready this morning? Come on, church. Are you ready? Anybody excited this morning? I'm excited. You know why I'm excited? It's Jesus alive. You know what? It doesn't matter how we feel or how small. Maybe there's nobody here right now, but you know what? It's okay. One day this place is going to be packed out to the brim. We're going to be shouting. We're going to be just having a great time. It doesn't matter how big the circumstance is. God is in control. When God is in it, it's awesome. Let's stand this morning and let's get excited about Jesus, right?
One, two.
loving kindness is better than life. He's promised to give us abundant life, eternal life, a heavenly life. We are seated with Christ in heavenly places. Now let's sing it. Jesus. Understand that. Help us, Lord. Guys, ready? Let's keep our hands going.
Start a new revival.
me. Hear you shout. You guys ready? Let's declare it this morning. Just like he did it before. Sing it. Here we go. Just like he did it before. There you go. Lord, we. That's right. Just like you did it before. Lord, we are ready for more. That's right. Tell them. Just like you did it before. Lord, we are ready for. Fill our cups. Before. Lord, we are ready for more. Yeah. Just like he did it before. Yeah. Lord, we are ready for more. To go to the Kern River out here? Can we do it on our own? No. We need the Holy Ghost. Right, Pastor Anthony? We can't do it. Because you know what? We'll get tired. Oh, I want to sleep about 10 minutes, you know. No. We need the Holy Ghost every second, every minute, every hour. I know I do. I have to have the Holy Ghost. Because you know what? I'm not a good person. If I didn't have God in my life, the Holy Spirit, I wouldn't even have a job because I'd run. I would do all kinds of crazy things and ruin it. Right, Alice? People that know me, they know that. Fill me with the Holy Ghost fire. Tell them. I need the Holy Ghost fire. I need the Holy Ghost fire. Fill me with the Holy Ghost fire. I need the Holy Ghost. That's right. Come on. Fill me with the Holy Ghost fire. I need the Holy Ghost fire. Tell him. Make that your prayer. I need the Holy Ghost fire. Fill me with the Holy Ghost fire. I need the Holy Ghost fire. Tell him one more time. Fill me with the Holy Ghost fire. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Fill us up, Lord. Worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Right, Maria? We worship him, right? Isn't he awesome? I hear you back there. I hear you worshiping. Yes, Lord, yes. Because you know. You've seen it. You know the power of God. Power of the cross.
The one.
cross is waiting there with open arms. Can you see the scars in his hands? For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only. Hello. Live. Feel his loving arms just wrap around you right now. Oh Lord, wrap me in your arms. Wrap us in your love. Wrap us with your amazing presence, your amazing peace. Lord, peace that passes all understanding. I have felt that peace in my life. Lord, I remember. Can you guys remember maybe a time in your life where you didn't think you were going to get out of maybe a situation or a circumstance, maybe you were going through something, and turn on that one song, or maybe just it might not even be a song. I remember there being times in my life where I wouldn't have made it through. I believe this with all my heart. I wouldn't have made it through if it wasn't for God just meeting me, you know, because it wasn't me. It wasn't me getting a hold of God or anything like that. It was him, his mercy and grace, just touching me and saying, Ross, I am here. And the peace of the presence of God, just tears. I remember one time just crying. I had so many tears. I was crying so much. It was ridiculous. And you can't stop it. And it's not tears of pain or sorrow. It's tears of saying, I cannot believe what you've done for me, God. I can't believe what you've brought me through and what you're bringing me through. Isn't that awesome? Are you guys happy? Are you guys excited this morning? That's why when I first started, we come in sometimes, we feel like, oh man, here I am, another day. No. No. When we push through, when we ask God, help us. Help me to motivate me. I can't make it. I don't feel like going on. I don't feel like going to church. I don't feel like waking up. When we keep pressing forward and we say, no. All right, the goodness of, devil, you're a liar. I'm going to get up this morning. I'm going to lift my head up. The mountains where my help comes from. When we do that, guess what? The great physician, the great healer, the great I am, he meets us right where we are, and he lifts us out of that miry clay. And this morning, that presence you feel, it's not because I'm up here with Pastor Anthony jumping around and, come on, you're going to, No. We're simply encouraging. I'm encouraging myself. When I do that, guess what? I'm the one that needs it. So I'm just saying, oh, will you go on this journey with us? Just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Oh, I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Come on, church. Every dark addiction starts to break. name is healing. Your name is love. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like fire. Oh, I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety. To every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. You guys ready? Declare it. Your name. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn light. Church. Shout Jesus from the mountain. Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family. I speak the holy name. Jesus. Your name. Your name is power. Stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Your name is power. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Oh, thank you, Lord. Break every stronghold, shine. Sing that part. Your name is. Here we go. One. Yes. That's awesome. That's awesome. Break every straw. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold.
Shine through the shadows. Burn
like fire. Just reach your hand. Just extend it to your neighbor. Come on, everybody, just extend your hand lay your hand on your neighbor. Let's just begin to lift up our brother, our sister right now. We're all going through something. We're all going through a circumstance or a situation. You know what? We don't know what the next person's going through. So let's just begin to intercede as we sing this song. We're going to declare right now, not only for Oildale, for Bakersfield, but for California. Right now, right here in this church in Oildale, Open Gate Alliance Church, there are going to be breakthroughs. There's going to be souls saved by the thousands in Bakersfield. God's going to use Open Gate Alliance to reach the world for Jesus. So let's believe it this morning. Come on, let's just dig deep. Lord, help us. Lord, fill us. We lift your name on high. Break every addiction, Lord. Break every stronghold in my life, Jesus. Anxiety has to flee in your presence. Anxiety has to flee. Pain and fear, worry has to go. Generational cycles, generational curses are broken in your name.
That you give to us, not because we deserve it, but because it's grace, and no one in this world will ever deserve those blessings. We just thank you and receive every single one of them in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Why don't you get out of your seats for a few moments and greet your brother and your sister and tell them you're happy to see them at church this morning. All right, y'all. How you guys doing? Yeah? Awesome. By the way, I just want to say apologies because I know you went to the river and we weren't there that morning. Well, we've been there ever since, but that morning. Awesome. I know. I'm so sorry. Okay. We got your number now. We got you. All right. So, hey, guys, it was a busy weekend, busy week, busy month. In fact, it's so busy that there's one thing that we're going to be postponing a little bit, and that is our gamers tournament, the gaming tournament. We're going to push it back a little bit. I'll let you guys know. I got to talk with the venue, but because we've been so busy, we haven't been able to do some of the promo that we wanted to do. I have some different irons in the fire regarding this, and they're just still not coming to fruition. So it's okay, though. I'll just talk to the venue, and we'll push it back a little bit. But we're still going to have it, but we're just going to push it, so we can do it right. So we can. Before we go into the announcements, I wanted to go to show you some pictures of some things that we did. What do we have first, Jim? What's the first picture before, right after the greeting? Okay, all right, so pause right there. Okay, there's a picture. You see all that stuff? We have a storage over on Airport Drive and China Grade Loop. There's a Darrell's. Was it last year? Yeah, last year. Because we got so much food and so much stuff, we had like 6 pallets of food donated to us. And I was looking at that trailer on a hot August day, and I was like, Lord, have mercy. What are we gonna do with all that stuff? I called this guy. And he said, "Are you sure you want some food?" Yeah, I think we'll be all right. He brought it all over here, all the stuff. I was like, oh, my gosh, Lord, have mercy. 6 pallets of food. Now, we don't have a unloading dock. So he backed up right by the deal, right by our fellowship hall. So when you don't have a loading dock and you don't have a pallet jack, guess what you do? One box at a time. We unloaded it on one of the hottest days of the summer. I was dying. So I unloaded it, put it in. Half of it was inside the fellowship hall, and half of it was outside of the fellowship hall. And I was thinking, what am I going to do? We can't leave this out here. It's going to go bad. So I called Jim, and I was like, bro, you need to help me. We're dying here. So then we had to go get our church's trailer, my truck, come back, and then load it all back onto the trailer, onto the truck. Same day, hotter than where the enemy likes to hang out. Okay? Hotter than Arizona. And then we did it. One, no pallet jack, no loading dock, and started putting it back on my truck again. Okay? And then guess what we did? We drove it to the storage and then had to unload it again from the back of my truck and from the trailer, stack it all in there. Thank you, Jim. My goodness. My back would have been dying. But me and him were able to. Did we have Carter that time, or was it a different time? That was a different time? Okay, so yeah. Me and him, it was like, oh. It's one of those things where, like, you just get overwhelmed, and it's so spontaneous that nobody, I called around a bunch of people that nobody's available because it's right then and there. It's a hot day. And I was like, I don't want to go out there. I'm sorry, Scott. It wasn't on a Saturday. It was on a weekday. So that's why it was so hard. But we were stuck. So we had a storage, and we've been getting donations since then. And we've had different things given to us, and it's just we put it in there. We've taken stuff out, given a lot away. Blankets we've given over last year to this year. We've probably given out 150 blankets to the homeless. And those were all donated. So they, they heard. So about 150 blankets and a bunch of toiletries and different kinds of stuff, tons of clothes and food. But I told Jim that, and some of our folks that, we need an inventory team. I'll call it the Open Gate Resource Team. The Open Gate Resource Team, because we have so much stuff, so many resources, that we don't know what we have. So we got to figure out, how are we going to do this? How are we going to know what we have, be prepared so we can give it out, and then replenish what we have? We just got to be good stewards, you know? Otherwise, we're not going to get nothing. We're just going to, this is going to be it. And it's just going to be sloppy agape. You know, here's some broken up shoes. Here's some underwear. They're used. Do we want to do that, you know? So we got to figure out, we got to get on top of this. So I was like, it's still good. Just turn them around backwards. Just put them on backwards. I know. So we sat down a couple of weeks ago and we talked about how can we be better stewards. And we had a team, and we had a meeting after church. Remember, Alice, we had a meeting. Remember, Priscilla, we had a meeting. You guys had a meeting, and we had a meeting. And we went to the offsite storage, and they looked at it, and I said, this is what we have right now. What can we do with this? Okay, well, they started thinking about it. They started praying about it. And then, boom, they had an idea. They got it all figured out. So this Saturday, the Mangassers striked again. Because the prior Saturday we were over there cleaning Yvonne's house, doing the yard work. So the family was out here, and Jim was out there helping them. And while we have another team of people that are over at Napomo by the beach having a rally, the Open Broken Chains Suburb Recovery, they're over there. Otherwise, they would have been there too. But some of them would have been there. But look at these pictures here. Isn't that neat? Look at all that stuff. They pulled it all out, okay? That's where you start. Next picture. They're gearing everything up. Those are the shelving that they got. Next. Now they're doing they're figuring out what we have. They're going through it. They're separating all the clothing that we have, the different, summer, winter clothing, men's clothing, women's clothing. Okay, next. Now they're doing inventory. They're like, okay, here's what we're going to do, okay? Let me have a bite of that bagel there. It's like, donut there. All right, next picture. There's Maria. And so now, look at, they got it all organized. They got it all labeled. Next picture. Boom. All right. Do you think we're going to be efficient? Do you think we're going to be better at knowing what to do? Is that awesome? Way to go, guys. Home run. So now that's a team that was there putting it all together. We even got some young folks. Thank you, Jeannie Thomas and Maria, Yaya, and Jim. Go ahead, take it. Go back one, Jim. Go back. Go back one picture. We got a lot of peanut butter, so we're going to start making peanut butter cookies, and we're going to sell them. So for the Lord, glory to God. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Now, as we are managers and good stewards with God's resources, you know what God does, right? He gives us more so we can be better at what we're doing. And he is making us better. Right now, CR is over, a few folks from CR and Broken Chains, they're over in the beach, and they're getting equipped so they can be more efficient and better ministers and helping people get off drugs, get off addictions, get off hurts, habits, and hang-ups, things where there's cycles in their life, and they're helping people break those cycles in the name of Jesus to celebrate recovery. That's what they're doing right now. They've been there since Friday, and they're having a good time. I got a report for them. So that we have a few people that are doing that today. Also, we have some pictures of us from the... So here, yesterday, Charles and I, we have a friend that used to play the drums for us. He goes to our other church, the church that we came from, and he's the one. He started this organization called The Walk, and this is to make people aware of child abuse, and it's a walk against child abuse. And the slogan is, "How far will you go to stop child abuse?" And guess what he did? Last year, he started July 4th, San Francisco, and he walked across the United States. Ended the 23rd of December, he finished in New York City. Statue of Liberty. So he went isn't that crazy? Yeah. And this guy, he's come to the Lord few years ago. We took him to the men's retreat, and right there is where God really grabbed a hold of him, at a men's retreat, and walking with the Lord, and God had been using this man. And so they had a 5K walk yesterday at Riverwalk, and me and Charles, we took some of our equipment over there. So those are some of the walkers. Go ahead and go to the next slide. Those are some of the vendors. That's just one. There was about 8 or 9 vendors from different organizations here in Kern County, and they were over there supporting what the whole walk was about, to stop child abuse. Next slide. Can you go to the next slide? What? Okay. You don't see a picture of us at the river? Oh, go to the river. Go to the river announcement, river ministry announcement. So we were out there, and what our job was to we had two things we had to do. We had to go around the whole course, and that's what we use. We have a new tool at Open Gate. There it is, right there. Lyle, who used to sing with us when we would go out the river, he took his own golf cart, and we took the church's golf cart, and we would go there, and we would take a bunch of resources and stuff. And now he was going to another church where his kids go to on the other side of town, and his grandkids. So we said, "Praise the Lord, bro. You go with your family, hang out with, they can hang out with, the grandkids can hang out with Papa." But he said, "You know what?" Charles asked him, "Are you willing to, let go of that golf cart and allow Open Gate to get it?" He said, "For the right price." at any rate, we got a good deal. It's not going to be a huge pressure on us, but we got another golf cart for Open Gate. Yeah. So we took it out there to the Riverwalk, and our job was to put the signs down. Signs all around the course. So all around the whole park, we put the signs out. And then we were also, while the walk was going on, we were in charge of the water, giving everybody water, because we had water in the back there. We had a great time, didn't we, Charles? That was awesome, huh? Yeah, it was good. It was a long day. What time did you guys start, Maria? And what time were you guys done? Yeah, so praise the Lord. Thank you for that work of mercy. Thank you. But we got, the Lord is giving us more, so we can now double our impact on the river. We could be faster, maybe even add another day, or we can do the same day, but now we can utilize more resources to give out the stuff that you organize, so we can give out more. And we could pray for more people and really get a hold of people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. All right. So
with that, there's one last thing before we go into the announcements. We are ministers. We are a church that is reaching out. And not only is it done by the leaders or people that are always on the in the public's eye, but there are also other people. You don't have to be that. You can have a craft. You can have a talent in that way. So we have Gene and we have Joan, who are part of the ministry Stitches for Life. And that's Gene back there in the corner, and that's Joan back there in the corner. And it's just been beautiful having these gals with us. They have another team of people, and what they do is they put together quilts. They sew them, and Esther, how good is the quality? It's excellent. These guys are top-notch. You brought some? Bring some up here. Come on, let's celebrate this ministry. You don't have to be a speaker. You don't have to be a healer. You don't have to be all these things that we think you got to be. Whatever God has given you, pray and ask the Lord, and He will guide you on how you can use whatever you have to minister to others. And this is what their talent is. They make quilts. They're seamstresses. They can sew very well. And so they said, we're going to make prayer blankets. And they call it Stitches for Life. So let's see what let's allow these gals to show them. Come on up here. And just so you know, that's good, right? Yeah, there you go. So what they do is, you know, I'm sure that, you know, God gives them a design, and then down here, they have a label, and it says Open Gate Church, and then they also put the name of the person that they make it for. So it's like and they're praying, and in the name of Jesus, people are going to come to the Lord as these guys. So this one, yeah, Stitches for Life, and this one's for Judith Curley. This is one of the girls who we minister to at the Palms, and she's going to be getting this prayer. She's in the hospital. She hurt herself. She fell down, so we hadn't been had a chance to interact with her at the Bible study because we didn't know what was going on, confidentiality. But we figured it out, and Charles and Esther found out where she was at. They went to go visit her, and she was like, oh, my gosh, thank you. She was all happy that our team was there to minister to her, and so now we're going to bless her. These gals are going to bless her with a prayer blanket. Gene, do you want to tell us something about this ministry? Tell us, where did this come from?
All these quilts were made by Helen. You remember Kevin's mother? She left all these to us to finish. So then we'll just be making our own after we use all hers up. But she left us a bunch of them.
Praise the Lord. Awesome.
For us to keep doing this because she was in our little group.
Yeah. Well, we're so blessed to have you guys part of our team. And just so you know, Kevin's mom, she passed away a few, a month and a half ago, and we had a funeral for her over in Vessels of Honor Church, and I was able to speak there and give some words about, because she was here, she came, her and Kevin. Kevin is the one that he's a Native American, and he always says Osio. Yeah, he does the drum, the Native American, the drum, the tribal drum. So when we started our church at the Riverview Park, he was there, and he brought his mom there. That's how she's connected to Open Gate. She was coming to the church, and so she went to be with the Lord now, and so I was able to speak over there, and these gals are going to pick, they're continuing with the same ministry of this prayer blanket ministry, Stitches for Life. Thank you, Gene and Joan. We appreciate you guys so much. Come on up and share the announcements real quick, and then we'll jump into the rest of our stuff.
Well, again, good morning, guys. Welcome to Open Gate. So what we got going on Monday nights is Celebrate Recovery. 5:30 p.m. dinner, 6 p.m. worship and lessons, and then 7 to 8 we have group. That'll be right here at the church. Make a note, Bible study at the Palms, Tuesday mornings at 10 a.m. Study through the book of John right now. James 1:27 is there scripture. Open Gate Kern River Ministry. Thursday mornings at 8 a.m., meet behind the home run wall behind Samlin Ballpark on North Chester. All right, so we also have a woman's brunch Saturday, May 14th at Betsy Banks's home. It's going to just be a morning of fellowship and refreshing. And that's it. Awesome. Welcome back up, our pastor.
All right, let's pray. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for just what the things that you're doing in our midst. It is beautiful, and you are using us, and part of that is because you're giving us the abundant life, and that's the way we enjoy your abundant life, Lord, is by understanding how you made us and what we're made for. You give us purpose. So we thank you, Lord, for that. And we pray that you would open up our eyes, open up our hearts, so we can understand your word today the way you want us to understand it. I pray you help me to get out of the way and allow your words to have its full force upon our hearts, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. John chapter 4. John chapter 4. We went through John chapter 1, John chapter 2, John chapter 3, and let's go to the one before A.B. Simpson, the poem. There you go. New Life by A.B. Simpson. New Life. Just think about that. This is what we're going to be talking a little bit about. Go ahead. Next slide. Life's crisis has been passed, and I have come at last into the promised land of peace and rest. The crisis hour is over. And now, forevermore, I'm dwelling in God's blessing and God's best. It came, I know not how, but this I know, that now my life has found a new and nobler plane. Something has passed away. Something has come to stay. And I can never be the same again. The change is not in me. Rather, it seems that he has come himself to live his life in mine. And as I stepped aside and took him to abide, he came and filled me with his life divine. I came to Jordan's flood, and as with him I stood, the heavenly dove upon my spirit came. Just how I cannot tell, but this I know full well, that life henceforth can never mean the same. And yet it brings no strain, but hand and heart and brain move on with all the old simplicity. I do not have to try, for it is no more I. But Christ, who thinks and lives and moves in me. The testing hours have come in flesh and heart and home, but he was near my every load to share. New tasks have called me on, new victories have been won, but through the cloud and sunshine, he was there. Last one, no more I doubt or fear. The way shines bright and clear. And one who never can fail is leading on. He will not let me stray, but lead me all the way. Until the fight is fought, the crown is won. What is he talking about here? He's talking about the life that we live, the victorious life, the abundant life. I don't do it. He does it in and through me. Christ is in us. Every victory that we have, it's not because of how good we are. It's not because of how good of a battle we are. We put up. It's because of how great he is, how powerful he is. It's all about Jesus. It's all about him. And the plane that he's talking about, it's a higher plane, not the flying plane. It's when you walk levels, it's the highest plane. It's walking in Jesus and Jesus walking in us. He's speaking through us. He's reaching through us. He's thinking through us. And the mind of Christ is now on us. This is the ultimate goal of what God is talking about when we come to him. This is what John is talking about through the whole Bible, that we understand. If you read these words that I wrote and you understand them, you will have eternal life. You will have the life of Christ that he wants to give to us. You have to understand that that's the goal that he's trying to get us to understand. And so this is one of the instances, just one little snippet out of all of his writings of how he wants us to understand. And you can, if you understand this, you can walk and live at this higher plane. Aren't you tired of being, walking and hanging around, not with the turkeys, not even with the snakes? You're hanging around with the gophers underneath the ground. That's our plane for some of us. That's where we live. It's like this, not victorious, not above ground. We hide from the battle. We're crying because there's a battle. We're wondering, there's a battle? Yeah, no. When God is in you, you are flying above it, and he is just stomping and dominating everywhere you go. Fear no longer can captivate you. And that's the plane that he wants us to get on. That's the level of where God wants you to understand and interact with the world from. We minister at the river, and when there's a little trickle of water coming through, there'll be a boulder in the riverbed. And that little trickle of water will hit that boulder, and guess what will happen? It'll hit that boulder, and it'll go around it. It's a barrier. The water cannot go where that boulder is. It's preventing it from reaching that ground underneath it. But when a flood of water comes down the river, that little trickle of water and that rock is no longer a barrier. It just swallows up that rock. And the flow is bursting through, and the rock is nothing. It's like a little pebble. And that is the river of water, the river of the Holy Spirit, the flow of the Holy Spirit, and the plane that God wants us to walk in. Abundance. He wants to capture our mind. He wants us to walk in faith and not in doubt. And it comes from not your own ability to understand God, not your own ability to have faith. It comes from his. It's at our disposal. Last week we talked about Jesus. He gives a spirit. And he gives it in a way to us. Do you remember how he gives it? Remember, there was a description. Is it a little bit? Is it a medium? Is it a lot? How was that scripture? You guys remember? He says he gives it, the Holy Spirit, without limit. But the problem is, we don't believe it. We don't believe him. If he gave it without limit, then that would mean God was generous. And you know what? I've lived all my life, and God's not generous. Then you're just listening to old thinking, wrong thinking, your own experience telling you something, somebody else's experience who is telling you something. You're not listening to John's writing, to what that will equal. It will get you to, it's a ramp onto the plane that he wants you to be in. Aren't you tired of it? Hello? I look around and I talk about some things about what God is doing in our lives and people's lives. It goes over people's minds, over people's heads. And our desire is that people would walk in this fullness. So, let's read John chapter 4, verse 1. Let's see if we can walk in a higher plane that God desires for us as we understand this. You ready? Now, Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that he was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John. Why is that important? Because the Pharisees are always looking for who's popular, and then they go after that. Hello? That's what religion does. Are you religious? I'm sometimes religious. Can you say that? Say that about yourself. I'm sometimes religious. And here's one of the indicators. Whatever's popular in town, you go to it. Pop Christianity. Whatever book is the most best-selling book, that's what you're going to buy. The hottest speaking, preacher, that's what you're going to listen to. It's like, it's pop Christian. It's like, that's the latest Christian singer. You know? But that's the religion. It's important. But when the Pharisees saw that the people were going now to Jesus, John is no longer the popular one, John the Baptist. Now they're going after Jesus. They're like, oh, we got to do something. We don't want this nobody to be popular because he's starting to say something. He's starting to do something. And so they were focused on this. Verse 2. Although, in fact, it was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. So Jesus wasn't doing the baptizing. Jesus was giving them guidance, and they were baptizing. Verse 3. So he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. So he moves from the region of Judea, and now he's going to Galilee. Galilee is what? A lake, the Sea of Galilee, and he's going around to a different place where there's a lake of water. And it's if you see the Sea of Galilee, you could look it up on Wikipedia. They got pictures of it. You know what it looks like? It looks like Lake Isabella. It's that. It's like it's a lake in a desert. And that's what Lake Isabel looks like. It just looks like rocks all around it, you know. It looks just like that. Verse 4. Now he had to go through Samaria. Can you read that with me? Now he had to go through Samaria. Okay? Do you have to go? Do you have to go through Lamont? Do you have to go through Arvin? Do you have to go through Pumpkin Center? Do you have to go through Oildale? That's the way they looked at this statement here. Samaria was a place that nobody wanted, that no Jewish religious person wanted to go, because the Samaritans were, in their minds, they weren't full-blooded Jewish people. You know, that's still that spirit in this to this day. You're not full-blooded whatever. You're mixed. You're half. Whatever. You know, I'm a Native American, and my dad is a dark guy. My mom is white. She's German, Irish, and Italian. And, you know, people would see us, and guess what they would call me and my brother? You know what they call us? Yeah, they call us half-breed. Isn't that crazy? Horrible. Telling a little kid that. Like we're a horse or like we're animals. You know, you're supposed to be, you know, true blood. You know, you're supposed to be pure blood. Nobody's pure blood. So this is the way that they looked. They saw themselves better than these other folks. They looked down on the Samaritans. And so when they needed to go from one, if you went from Judea and you went to Galilee, you could take a shortcut and you would go through Samaria. It's the straightest way. But guess what all the Jewish people would do? Go around it. There's a freeway that goes through LA and it goes through Watts. Right there in the hood. And everybody that lives around there goes around it. They don't get on that freeway. This is somewhat of that idea. But Jesus says, John says, now he had to go to Samaria. Next verse. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar or Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. You guys remember Jacob? Jacob God changed the name of Jacob. And what's the name that he gave Jacob? What? Israel. That's right. That's where you get the name. Jacob's name was changed to Israel. God changed Jacob's name from Jacob to Israel, prince. And he gave this plot of ground, this area, this thing that we're going to see, to Joseph. All right, next verse. Jacob's well was there. And Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. You guys ever been tired? Maria, were you tired Saturday a little bit? Okay, I'm tired. I get tired. It's not a sin to be tired. Can I just tell you that? It's not out of the ordinary to be tired. Sometimes people are like, ah, this is horrible. Why? Because I'm tired. Jesus was tired. Okay? He was even taking a shortcut. It's okay that our flesh gets tired. Some people, they live their lives in such a way to avoid that word, tired. So everything evolves around their life and planning and getting things ready so they don't get tired. Jesus got tired, brothers and sisters. If we're going to follow Jesus, can I just say, your flesh might get a little tired. Okay? It's not the end of the world. Jesus was tired, and that also is an indicator that he wasn't just beyond our experience. Sometimes we say, oh, Jesus, you know, he doesn't understand because he don't know how tired I am. Yeah, he did. He does. He got tired too. He was physical. He was a human being. Here he is. He's fully God. He was fully man. He experienced being tired. As he was from the journey, he sat down by the well. It was about noon. So, 12 o'clock, he's sitting down there at the well. It's hot. It's desert. Next verse. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me drink?" So, most of the time, if you're in the desert, if it's hot, I know this even at the river, most people that are going to do work or do something, guess where they're going to do it? They're not going to do it in the heat of the day. They're going to do it in the cool of the evening, the cool of the morning. What is she doing work in the heat of the day? We're going to find that out. Next verse. His disciples had gone into town to buy food. So he's by himself. And the disciples were all excited because they were hanging out with Judas. And he had the bag of money. He's like, well, let's splurge. Let's get some, you know, some rabbit, some beef jerky, whatever. Next verse. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew." She understands the hierarchy. "You are a Jew and I'm a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." So she highlights this idea, this separation. She's honest. She's not trying to hide. It's like, oh, okay, here, I'll help you. It's like, what? She's blunt about it. "You're a Jew. I'm a Samaritan woman." It's okay to state the obvious. Sometimes we want to beat around the bush a lot. You know, our communication with each other would be a little bit better if we were a little bit more clear. You know, she's being straight and true regarding this interaction with him. Next verse. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." If you knew the gift of God, if you knew, do you know? Let me ask you a question. What do you know? This is a picture of the kind of prayers that we have as Christians. We think the physical thing that is hitting our physical life, I'm thirsty, I need stuff for my family. Fill up this thing here. Physically, I need this. Physically, I need this. But if you knew what you really need, if you knew what you really need, why didn't she know what she really needed? Why? Because like many of us, this is what we think we need right here, by what we see, by what we feel. Some of us, God is right before you. I don't know what your decisions are. I don't know the things you're contemplating in your plans. But if you knew Jesus being right before you, right, wanting to show you what you really need, you would ask him for it. You know what I get when I read this? Lord, I don't know what I need. I think I need to lose some weight. I'm working on that. I think I need this, that, and the other. I need more time. I need to make more money. I need to open up a business. I need this. I need that. And those things are okay to think about, but we're talking about a higher plane, brothers and sisters. We're talking about a higher level. If you knew, do you know? Do you know? And it's okay to say, I don't know. That's the problem with a lot of us. We think we know. I know. That's the people's favorite phrase. Hey, you know what you should do? You should do this. I know. Well, then why don't you do it? Because I know. I thought you said you knew it, but you didn't do it. I know. No, you don't know. If you knew. If you knew. The gift of God. Oh, Lord, help us to know the gift of God. What are the gifts of God? What is the gift? It's not a plural. This is a singular. It's not more than one. A gift is one. The gift of God. What is a gift? It's Jesus. It's the person of Jesus. A.B. Simpson, this poem, he knew that that was a gift. It's Jesus living in me. The wisdom, the compound ideas that come from when I'm walking with the Lord and I'm just spending time with him, and I'm reading and I'm thinking about his scriptures, and I'm like laying everything aside because I don't know what I need, but I know he's the gift of God. So, Lord, what do I need? What do I need? And then, boom, he starts happening. It starts coming. It starts flowing into you. If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. We sang about this. Fire. We talked about the water, the river of life, the river that flows, the river of the Holy Spirit flooding. And you know what? If you know, as I look at people who are gophers, living the gopher life, you know what people do to kill gophers? You know what people do? They put water in the hole. And some of us, we're in the hole, and the water of the Holy Spirit needs to flush us out. Come above ground. Come on. And then the flow needs to take us higher. He's trying to dig us out of our holes, and he wants us to walk in confidence. He wants us to walk in the best things that he has for us, the poverty life that people are stuck in this cycle of thinking. It's constant because they don't know the gift of God. They don't know the gift of God. And there's still no movement. They're not going forward, and they're not getting higher. They're still, I'm going to dig deeper. And they're eating roots. God wants you to know the gift of God because he wants you to have living water. And what is the way we get there? We're going to stop right there. We're going to learn more next week. about this whole interaction. Do you know she experiences this living water? Did you know that real quick, real fast? Did you know that? We're going to learn more about it, but she said, you know, the interaction with Jesus is like, okay, well, hey, tell me about this living water so I don't have to keep coming here. Go get your husband. I don't have a husband. You're right. You have many husbands. And the one you're with is not your husband. In other words, Jesus knows how broken we are. Jesus knows our problems, yet he still wants to give you living water. You just got to be honest. He's not beating around the bush. She wasn't beating around the bush. Living water is there when we are talking and when we're real. She is touched by the Master. She's touched by the gift of God. She sees it. And then she, what does she do with this experience? She runs to the people where she's from, the Samaritan village, and she tells them, I met Jesus. She understood it was fresh. He's the gift of God. She knew. If you only knew. I know now. He's the gift of God. He told me everything I've done. Could he be the Messiah? And they all come and they all believe. They have a revival. Quickly. Living water. She got it. She received it. She didn't go home and say, okay, I'll get it when I get rid of the guy that I'm living with and I'm shacked up with, and I'm going to change my life. I'm going to live a few years, right? And then everything's going to be okay. The living water's going to come. No. Boom. She knew the gift of God. Lord, help us to know the gift of God. And our prayer, our asking would be appropriate. It would flow from knowing the gift of God, knowing how much he loves us, knowing how much he wants to prosper us, knowing how much he wants to bless us, knowing his benevolence, his goodness, knowing and being confident that he's going to give it to me. Not because of how good I am, but because I know the gift of God. I know the gift of God. And when you do that, your prayer just changes. Now that we know the gift of God, give me living water, Lord. I want to go higher. I want to fly high. I want to go farther. Oh, Lord, help me. Why does he want us? Why does he want this? He doesn't want us to. You notice she wasn't there, and she was just enjoying it for herself. Do you understand this? The living water has a compound effect on you, and it's so powerful that it can affect a city. It can affect a village. That's the compound effect of God's blessing. It's not just for you. It's not just for your family. It's not just for your little group. If you know the gift of God, it will affect villages. It will affect other people, because God doesn't want us to do it by ourselves. He wants us to enjoy this together. Can we start here? Can we start here at Open Gate? Will our prayers change? Great and mighty prayers. Give me living water. Lord, I'm tired. I did some things. But I'm tired. I'm ashamed of what I've done. I don't want to go when everybody goes to the water. I want to go only when I'm there, because I'm ashamed of my life. He will give you living water. It doesn't matter. He will give you living water if you know the gift of God, who is right here even today. He's right in our midst. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us where we've thought we knew who you were, and our prayers were itty-bitty prayers. We thought the physical things that we needed, we brought those to you. But Lord, you want to give us, oh, so much more. Help us to know. Help us to know. What is standing in the way, Lord, of helping us to know, of allowing us to know you, the gift of God? Lord, I pray that the writings of John, that the Logos, the living water, the living word, and would just touch us right where we're at, Lord. And we're confident that you will hear us. Because you said to ask for living water, and you would give it. You will give the Holy Spirit without measure. No limits. Limitless. So, Lord, in the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord, you would just teach us about that. Show us your limitlessness. Show us, open up our eyes so we could pray appropriately, so we can ask you appropriately, so we could ask confidently, and that others could be affected by how you have filled us. My goodness, Lord. Wow. You blow us away, Jesus, of what you want to do in our lives. Help us to go at that higher plane. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We turn a corner. We're going to pray for our offering this morning. And you can do it. There you go. All right. We have an usher and an usherette this morning. Awesome. Why don't you pray for the offering, my brother?
Thank you. Let's bow our heads. Gracious Lord, we're so grateful this morning for your word. Thank you for touching our spirits, opening our minds to receive such good news. We're so grateful for all the things you're doing in the community. Thank you for using us. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to be able to touch lives. We are so blessed. Father, as we give today, we ask that you take what is given today and multiply it to where we can continue to do what it is you've asked us to do. And that's to give a part of you through us to other people, that they too can experience the loving kindness that you have and the love that you have for us, your creation. Thank you, Father. We really love you, and we thank you so deeply for this opportunity to give. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, fill me till I want no more. Fill my cup. Fill it up and make me. Let's stand together. Let's sing that again. Fill my cup, Lord. Fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. This thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, bread of, fill me till I want no more. Fill me till I want no. Fill my cup, fill my, fill it up. Fill it up and make me whole. That is, man, that's a long, that was, what is, that was 80s for me. What did, was that 70s? Did that, was that further? In the, really, 70s. That was way back. Come on, girl. I pray the challenges that God has before you, you will realize there's physical challenges are there just to remind you. Something God wants to give you more. Ask him. I don't know what I need, Lord. Show me, and then I will act according. I will pray accordingly, and I will walk in the living word, the gift that he has for us. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.